Hello everyone, this is me Dr. Alim and I welcome you all to enjoy another video lecture on ancylostomiasis or hookworm infection, particularly Ancylostoma caninum infection. And in this video lecture I'm going to talk about important species under the genus Ancylostoma and morphological features of that genus, life cycle of Ancylostoma caninum, pathogenesis, clinical presentation, and finally diagnosis and prevention of Ancylostomiasis or hookworm infection. So under the genus Ancylostoma, there are some important species that are responsible for causing a disease called Ancylostomiasis or hookworm infection in dog, cat, even in human. So the most commonly occurring species in dog, fox, different other carnivores is Ancylostoma caninum. And there are two more important species that also causes Ancylostomiasis in cat and different other canids. They are Ancylostoma tubiformis and Ancylostoma brasiliensis. Just for your information, for human, there are two important species. They are Ancylostoma duodenale and another one is Necator americanus. So all these parasites will be found in a small intestine of the final host, and these parasites are distributed in tropical and subtropical regions of the world. Morphological features of the genus Ancylostoma. The size of the parasite is around 1 to 2 cm. They are smaller than the size of different ascaris worms. The color is gray to reddish in color, but the color will depend on the presence or absence of the blood in intestine. One of the important features of these parasites are hook-like posture or hook posture. That is, the anterior portion of this parasite is slightly bent, and the oral aperture is directed anterior dorsally. Therefore, this parasite is also known as hookworms. As it is a bursa nematode, the male will have very well-developed bursa. And there are some important features which is very useful for morphological identification of this parasite, that is presence or absence of teeth in the buccal capsule. For an example, for Ancylostoma caninum and Ancylostoma tubiformis, there are three pairs of teeth in the buccal capsule. And for Ancylostoma brasiliensis, there are two pairs of teeth located in the buccal capsule. And these teeth can be located either dorsal margin of the buccal capsule or ventral margin of the buccal capsule. For an example, teeth are located dorsal margin of the buccal capsule for Ancylostoma caninum and Ancylostoma brasiliensis, but for Ancylostoma tubiformis, the teeth are located ventral margin of the buccal capsule. The life cycle of Ancylostoma caninum. Life cycle is a direct life cycle as there is no involvement of intermediate host. The infective stage is L3 and there are four routes of infection. The first one is peroral route of infection, second one is percutaneous, third one is transmammary, and the fourth one is transplacental route of infection. So transplacental route of infection is less common route of infection. So in the life cycle, the predilection site for the adult parasite is the small intestine, and the female parasite will lay eggs. The eggs will be passed through the feces, and in the environment, the egg will be hatched out to produce infective stress, that is L3. So our final host can be infected by four routes, as I mentioned earlier. The first one is peroral route of infection. So in this case, a final host can be infected after having L3 with contaminated food and water, and this L3 will directly pass to the intestine and become adult parasite. But some of the L3 penetrate the buccal mucosa and they will follow the percutaneous route of infection. So in percutaneous route of infection, that is infection by penetration of the skin by the L3. So this percutaneous route of infection will contribute to the transmammary route of infection, and another one is transplacental route of infection. So usually after penetration of L3 in the body, they will move to the move to the lung via blood stream, and afterwards there will be a molting in the lung, that is L3 to L4. So when these stages are coughed off and swallowed, they will reach to the intestine and become adult parasite after molting, after final molt, that is L4 to L5. And from here, during migration or migration via the bloodstream, some of them will move to the skeletal muscle and will remain there as dormant condition. So these inactivated larvae will become activated at around 3 weeks before parturition, and they will move to the mammary gland as L3. So the young pups or puppies will be infected after having this L3 via milk. So this L3 will reach to the small intestine of the puppies, and there will be development of the adult parasite. And while the percutaneous infection, some of the L3 will move to the offspring via placenta, and after birth there will be a molting, that is L3 to L4 in the liver or in the lungs, and afterwards they will follow this route of infection, that is these stages will be coughed off, swallowed, and reach to the infection and become adult parasite after final molting. So in summary, direct life cycle, infective stage is L3, four routes of infection. The first one is paroral route of infection, and the second one is percutaneous route of infection, which contributed to the transmammary route of infection, as well as transplacental route of infection. And from paroral route of infection, some of the L3 will move to the, will follow the percutaneous route of infection. So this is the end of the life cycle of Ancylostoma caninum. So this is the simple illustration of the life cycle of Ancylostoma caninum. So here, the eggs will be passed through the feces, and in the environment, there will be development of L3 stages. So final host can be infected after having L3 with contaminated food and water. Or if the L3 are ingested by the lizards, that is some of the peritoneal host, they will be ancested there, and final host become infected after having these peritoneal host. And another route of infection, that is percutaneous route of infection, this L3 will migrate to the skeletal muscle and remain dormant there for a period of time. So before 3 weeks before parturition, they will move to the mammary gland as L3, and the puppies or pups will be infected after having the milk with contaminated with L3, and you know this L3 will be shut down for around 3 weeks. And this L3 will also contribute to the cutaneous larval migrants, that is some of the unnatural host will be infected, and they will migrate to the skin of the host and produce a lesion, serpentine lesion. Okay. So pathogenesis of Ancylostoma caninum infection or Ancylostomiasis. First, I would like to highlight what happens when a patient or a dog infected via percutaneous paroral route of infection. So you know the adult parasite ingest mucosal layer. This is also known as a plaque feeder. And this parasite is also a voracious blood sucker. They will suck, that is a parasite can suck 0.01 to 0.09 ml per day. So what happens when there is plaque feeding as well as blood sucking continues? So there will be the hemorrhage. So hemorrhage normally starts after 8 days post-infection. And one of the interesting thing, this parasite releases Ancylostoma caninum anticoagulant protein XA. The function of this factor is to prevent blood coagulation. As a result, there will be continuous leakage of blood from the intestine, and there will be generalized hyperproteinemia. Due to the continuous leakage of the blood from the intestine, as well as due to the blood sucking activities of the adult parasite, there will be anemia in adult as well as puppies. If there is anemia in adults or older puppies, it can be compensated by increasing erythropoiesis. So less severity of the anemia can be seen. But if it is occurred in newborn puppies, there will be less compensation as the bone marrows are underdeveloped. As a result, there will be severe anemia can be seen. And normally, they are normocytic, normochromic anemia, but later on, macrocytic and hyperchromic anemia are seen. In this case, animal may die within 10 to 20 days post-infection. 10 to 20 days post-infection. And another thing can be happened due to the losses of intestinal mucosa followed by damage of the intestinal mucosa. There will be this damage will act as the route of entry for other bacteria. As a result, there will be inflammation and contributed to the diarrhea after four days post-infection. And the feces color would be tarry color, and there will be presence of some watery mucus. So in this picture, you can see the immature hookworms on the mucosal layer, and here you can see the damage caused by the parasite. So in case of percutaneous route of infection by the infective agent L3, that is skin penetration by the larvae of the L3, and this will result moist eczema to ulceration, especially on the affected feet or interdigital spaces. And the clinical sign will include foot stamping and as well as itching of the affected sites, and this may contribute to the lameness of the animal. And due to the skin penetration by the larvae, there will be a wound in the affected site, and due to the continuous irritation, there will be leaking and biting of the affected site, which also contributed to the secondary bacterial infection. As a result, moist eczema to ulcerated lesion will be found. And if the L3 will reach to the lungs, there will be hemorrhagic pneumonitis, and in severe cases, there is consolidation of the lung due to the granulomatous inflammation. And just for your information, severity of the infection depends on intensity of the infection, age of the host, nutritional status, iron reserve, and the overall immune status of the host. Clinical sign of Ancylostoma caninum infection or ancylostomiasis: there will be weight loss or underweight, and pale gums due to the anemia, and overall weakness. There will be a bloody diarrhea, poor body coat, and itchy paws due to the percutaneous route of infection. L3 will penetrate the interdigital spaces and produce a sign which is called stamping of the legs. And some of the L3 can also reach to the lungs. As a result, there will be hemorrhagic pneumonitis. So pneumonic sign can also be found. And finally, the bad consequences of the disease is the death of pups due to the severe anemia. Diagnosis of ancylostomiasis or ancylostoma caninum infection: we should carefully check all the clinical history, as well as we should check the clinical sign for different lesion that I have mentioned in my earlier slide. And if we want to confirm the ancylostoma caninum infection, we should go for coproscopy. In that case, we may get characteristics eggs. For the prevention of this disease, the pregnant bees should be dosed with anthelmintics at least once during a pregnancy. And for the nursing litter or the newborn puppies, dose should be at least twice. That is immediately after birth, within 1 to 2 weeks of parturition, and again 2 weeks after the first dose. So these are the reference books that I have used during preparation of this presentation.
And I have also taken a lot of open source information from internet. And thank you for watching this video. And please stay with this channel to get more videos on Helminthology. Thank you.